Recently appointed ICT and Information Minister Frank Tumwebaze has adopted a robust communication strategy to bring the gap of information between government and the citizens. During a dialogue between media owners, telecom IT companies and other stakeholders at the Sheraton Kampala Hotel, Tumwebaze unveiled a model which will rely on more on pragmatism to deliver information, service delivery and create feedback from the public. On the spot tonight is the minister himself, the Honorable Frank Tumwebaze. Honorable Frank Tumwebaze, welcome to the show. You're on the spot tonight.
Thank you, Patrick. Nice being here once again after a while.
Barely after your appointment, the president issued a letter where he places a number of bodies under your docket, including NITA, New Vision, UCC, UBC, and others. What exactly will be your role, and why did he try to do it like that?
Thank you, Patrick. Maybe before I answer, first I should first of all thank you, all of you, including NTV. That really turned up at our, we call it maiden. It was the first one since our appointment to interact with the stakeholders. It was a wonderful conversation. We received views, we exchanged views, and I stated there, and I want to repeat, that that's how I want to engage with the stakeholders. It's not about I talk, they listen, and that's it. It's about an engagement. Well, what the president is doing, in the constitution, the president is empowered to create new departments of government, to merge others, to reorganize government as he deems fit for the proper functioning and delivery of public services. Now, when you look at the communication sector of government, it had two arms. It had the communication angle, the information bit, a minister called Minister of Information and National Guidance, which he also supervised the state broadcaster. Then there was the ICT ministry that also had aspects of the same ministry. So what the president was doing actually is what many people quite often accuse him of. I mean, trying to rule out duplication and to ensure that one department speaks to another. Because assuming that today I called that dialogue only in a capacity of Minister of Information and National Guidance, okay? And the TVs, as they were doing today, raised their issues of digital migration, this and that. Now, from the old arrangement, the Minister of Information had no supervisory powers over the regulator UCC. Now, that was a different ministry now. But you see now, because of the merger, all the agencies were speaking to one another, and you, the clients of government, the people they regulate and the people we serve as a country, we are in one room. I think it's going to really make work easier for government. And that's what you people need.
But also we know that the president, during this term, he said the ministers who will sleep on the job will face a sack. Are you also taking on the cue from that to be?
Well, he's the appointing authority. He's tried to make himself much more clearer on what he expects ministers to deliver. Okay? He's telling you, I mean, it shouldn't be business as usual. He's not going to accept routine. He was clear, you remember, in his detailed instructions. I want this fixed. I want the price of electricity of Bujagar negotiated. I want the standard gauge rail negotiations to be complete. I thought that's what Ugandans really would want to see, a government that has clear KPIs, key indicators that must be delivered on time, and which you can be able to measure. And when we come in with the communication angle, with the desire and determination to open up government, how do you open up government? You open up government by communicating frequently, factually, and timely. When you empower the citizen and they know what this department is doing, you stimulate their demand for services, of what government is doing, because they know what you're offering, when, where, and how.
So how are you going to eliminate what we have seen? You said you want to communicate frequently and timely and others. Mm. But we know sometimes when there's a national disaster or something, most often you'll find a government minister, everybody wants to speak. And sometimes you even you contradict yourselves. And you give us a problem, we in the media, because when we quote you and we quote another person, we find you're clashing. That happens a
lot. That's good. That's what the merger is trying to cure. Okay? Yes, you have the official government spokesperson, the Minister of Information. But I have noted, you being the Minister of Information, you are the government spokesperson, you communicate for cabinet, okay? You communicate collectively what you have agreed on. But what is key and important is that each sector has a leader, a core minister, and the respective people. So what you do, you offer a platform for them to communicate. That's why, for example, you are not going to hear me closing up the spokesperson of the police. I won't shut up Padankunda, Kano Padankunda for the UPDF, okay? Because they are the technical leaders in their sector.
What brings the confusion and the contradictions that are so common?
Well,
you never seem to have, as government, this narrative that say this is the Ugandan strategy, this is what we're pushing.
We are moving to that. I am sure the NTV of 5 years ago is not the NTV of today. You have improved. Maybe you have better gadgets than you used to have. So government also is manned by people like you and me, okay? Not everybody is a good communicator. Not everybody has been schooled in principles of effective communication. So that's what we are trying to build. And that's why for me, I'm not saying it's going to be a Tumwebaze-led idea. Tumwebaze will bring everybody. That's why we had the dialogue today. You people, we supply information. What are the challenges you get? We also want to hear, what do the government communicators, what is the experience also with the media?
So, if I may, how has this flawed communication strategy, if I may call it a strategy, affected the service delivery and maybe in a way affected the image of government as failing to deliver what point is expected of it?
Yeah, point number one, communication opens up government, as I said, it fosters accountability. When you communicate what is in your sector, okay? If you tell people, for example, that our mining policy is this, that we have the following minerals in these parts of the country, that we have given certificates or licenses to the following companies, you are being transparent. You are telling people in Ibanda, you are telling people in Karamoja, that in your area, for example, there is this company licensed to mine this. Their rights are these, your rights are these. Now, if you don't communicate, people do not know what is entitled to them, what is it government is doing. Now, and that's where sometimes people think we are doing political spinning. It's different from that. Actually, if we don't communicate, okay, we are cheating the public because we are paid, we take money from the budget to deliver services. So that's why we would want each government. We have agreed today, and I'm taking this to next level, to make sure that every month we have what they call a national baraza. This baraza is not about you hearing the Minister of Information all the time. No. If this month it is the sector of education, the Minister of Education, with all its technical people and their minister and the agencies, will come and talk about their education policy, what they are doing, what challenges they are doing, and also receive feedback. Now, we shall also, at that moment of the baraza, have collected prior issues from the public through a 24-hour call center, which we shall soon unveil to the public. We are still processing the code through UCC, just like the police has 999 and all that, and you can access the net. So we want to have a national code. So we will be announcing that this month, it is the Minister of Health coming. Fire in your questions. It is this. So the government is communicating.
Now, that
helps us two things.
Are you ready to take in the expose that will come, for example, in some of the ministries? Mm. You bring the Minister of Health. People will come from as far as Abim. I'm bringing Abim because of, at least in the campaign, what came from Abim was quite ugly. I mean, what will it be if you show the dirt, but probably it is there, and yet you do not have a mechanism to cure it?
No, there is a mechanism. If a Beam Hospital is not yet fixed, you, the person responsible for fixing it, tell us when you will fix it and the plan. The fact that a Beam is not yet fixed, Kabongo could be fixed, and I'm sure it's there. Okay? Because like today somebody from the media made something interesting, I think it was my friend Simon Kasiate. It's not news when a dog bites a man, and it's only news when the man is biting the dog. A broken down, a seemingly dismantled hospital structure is newsworthy, where a brand new hospital is not. Okay? So that's what I was telling the government departments, that if you don't tell your story, someone else will either gloss over it or ignore it or tell it the wrong way. So we shall, yes, ABIM is not done. But people in ABIM want to know what plans you have for it. We will create that platform and that accountability. I haven't done ABIM. I am the Minister of Health, but I have done Kobong. I have done Bushenyi. I am coming to this. I am coming to that. That is really the kind of responsiveness we would want government to show and demonstrate in its initiative to interact more with the citizens.
Most often we, in the media, you have a topic, you want to discuss about it, it's a national issue, and you call members of the opposition are quick to take the opposition the chance to come and talk. You call government officials, they are very slow to come.
We'll so, sort of that.
How are you going to do that? Because I know in the previous term of service of the president, you almost you acted like a minister of information. You used to be there. But why? Because sometimes people were slow in responding to calls.
Those are lessons that people should know. Communication is now among the key priorities the president has put up. Okay? It's normal. You cannot claim to be breaking walls of challenges and registering success when you're not telling the clients who pay you. In this case, our clients are the citizens who pay tax, and we are paid through budget money to deliver them a service. You must explain, really. We are trying to make sure that we mainstream this as a method of work, and each ministry will organize. Rightly so, not everybody communicates, Patrick. And that's why, if you read that letter of the president, he's asking each ministry to have government communication officers as a profession. People like you who are qualified in that area should find jobs. Just like an auditor has a job. Not everybody who will go and make the books of accounts. Like a protocol officer. Not everybody you may ask and say, what's wrong with receiving presidents and showing them where to sit? It's beyond that. Protocol is a discipline that somebody qualified in. So is communication. So to me, really, it's very... So each ministry will have a communication person attached to it, and that communication person, his or her job will be to pay full-time attention to gathering content of their ministry and plans for dissemination. It's really a standing order now.
But then we have seen a situation whereby a reporter, you're up out in the field and you get a government spokesperson or somebody who speaks for any agency, and you have a probing question and you throw a question there and he's evading you.
Well, that has been a weakness, and that's what we intend to fix. That's what we... Because people have been scattered. You get the point. People have been scattered. Reporting channels have been different. So when you see us creating this point of convergence, that also creates responsibility. Centers will be clear, reporting will be clear, and information will be much more managed. And you see, of course, you have to respond to the changing times. Okay? Even you, the media, had no space and capacity to consume all that the government would give you. The channels were not there. You had one TV, three radio stations. But today, I was having a chat with this professional man, Peter Mwesige, the lecturer of journalists. He said that newspapers today cannot afford to ignore certain things, because you see, like they say in parliament, you cannot speak until you've caught the eye of the speaker. Now, it's like a story cannot run in a paper if it has not convinced the editor. But because of social media revolution, certain things the papers cannot ignore them, depending on the intensity of debate they have generated online. So governments too must respond to that challenge. It's no longer just mere PR.
So let us try to shift gears here and talk TV. There are people who are watching and listening to you tonight, but there are those who probably may not be able to do that because they have been switched off, simply because maybe they have run out of subscription, and yet this is a free-to-air TV. So what will you do to these pay TVs that also make Ugandans pay for what is supposed to be free?
I receive.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do. Why? I am not yet an expert in digital migration. I'm still also getting briefed and learning. But our maiden dialogue today was very important. We received very, very passionate views. One of them was from your MD, Madam Agye Konde. And we have agreed that we need a session with the TVs. We need a session with UBC and its company, which distributes signal. And we discuss it, whether there is need for a policy review, whether there is need for someone somewhere to improve his or her efforts in the infrastructure of the technology. It's something we'll fix. And to me, that's why I'm happy now. Because if we didn't have that dialogue, perhaps we wouldn't have got feedback. And that's why we'll continue to have those feedbacks. And that's why our proposed monthly baraza for ministries. By the way, those barazas, we should even invite members of the opposition. Okay? Come and critique. You know, some of them, I choose them of not offering alternative policies. Come, you are a shadow minister of sector. Why? Okay? We have a national baraza, and our guest entity is the Minister of Health. And you are a shadow minister of health. Come and bring up your ideas. You are an association of dentists. You are an association of gynecologists. Come and tell us. How would you want us to fix Mulago? You see, Patrick, it's not about throwing criticism for the sake of it, for just propaganda value and political expedience. It should be positive criticism of building our country. And when that positive criticism comes up logically at a platform that everybody is seeing, me, the minister of that sector, I can't dodge it.
But when you call for these barazas, is that an indication that you really probably have no idea what is happening? Because at least there has been a cry that the health, for example, ministry, the public health sector is limping. Education has its own problems. These things are known.
We want a conversation around them. Because what you say are known, it depends on how are they known. Because, for example, when we talk about education, what is the problem? There has been a perennial claim that teachers are underpaid. And government has made an effort to add on. And it's now evident that though a teacher for primary or secondary is not yet well paid, his or her salary is much higher than that of a primary teacher or secondary teacher of a private school. But when you look at how schools are performing in the rural areas, it is the rural school, the private schools with teachers that almost earn half pay, who don't even get paid during the month of the holidays. So what is that magic? What is that disease in the government schools? So dialogues will unearth all that. They will tell you absenteeism. They will tell you corruption, syndicated corruption. They will tell you ghost children, pupils of inflated numbers to steal capitational grant money. So really, if we open up government, everybody is put on task. And this rhymes. This is not just a Tumwebaze initiative. This is the spirit of this government. This is the spirit that the president launched here in his two consecutive addresses, both at the State of the Nation and at the budget. They need to be accountable.
We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we continue with that discussion. We'll be right back. Welcome back. You're watching On The Spot. My name is Patrick Kamara. My guest tonight is the Honorable Minister of ICT and Information, Frank Tumwebaze. There are those who believe that meaningful dialogue would deliver Uganda to some kind of a promised land. When can we see protagonists like Dr. Besigye, General Muntu, and President Museveni sit and dialogue and talk for the sake of Uganda?
Well, it's up to them. The other day, the president received members of parliament from the opposition. I think some are still serving, some are former. One is the Secretary General of DP. I've just read online that Dr. Kizza Besigye condemned them. So I think it takes two to tango. It's a challenge that leaders must understand, that you are not aspiring to be me. You are aspiring to lead Uganda. Leading Uganda is not about me who is in the chair now. Okay? It doesn't have to be a do or die against me. So, as far as I know, President Museveni, with due respect, is my party chairman, is my president. One of his best attributes, what he's known for, is dialogue.
Yeah, but he's
talking.
Your party chairman is quoted saying that he's going to be preoccupied with ensuring that he gets rid of opposition in the country. That's what he said.
Yeah, get rid of them, defeat them. The mission of every party is to win support. He's not saying I will get rid of them by killing them or by expelling them from the country. So you have to put it in the right context. So I don't know what he said.
What is the right context when you say
every politician is aiming at winning?
Look, Dr. Kizza Besigye is currently incarcerated in Luzira prisons. And quite a number of people, including the clergy, have denounced this. Besigye has been arrested so many times without, you know, anyone finding him guilty. So why can't at least make it speedy?
He has a court in case, and it's unfair that we discuss court matters. He will go to court and prove himself. His conduct is not strange. We all know it. So I don't know whether which clergy you've spoken to, whoever is concerned about Kizza Besigye being arrested should also be concerned.
I'll tell you, a man called Father Gaetano Batanyenda.
There are so many other fathers.
In Kitanga in Kavale.
It doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. He's not the only father. I can also tell you about my father. my parish priest, what he says. So whoever is concerned about Kizza Besigye being in Luzira should know that Kizza Besigye is not killed. Okay? He's not detained without any charge. He has a case in court. He's before the judiciary. Recently, he raised so many concerns in a manner that was actually extrajudicial. Fortunately, the Chief Justice responded to him. So, when the state has issues with you, it arraigns you in the courts of law. But beyond Besigye and his ambitions, Ugandans want to move forward. Okay? You cannot tell me that my political interests as Frank Tumwebaze should jeopardize the stability, the trade rights of people. I mean, it's a whole debate. While I want to exercise my rights, I must do so responsibly. I don't think if Kizza Besigye was president of Uganda today, okay, he would allow his opponent, told rallies in Owino, told rallies at Constitutional Square, told rallies and processions in town. Tumwebaze Frank, I got 28,000 votes in my small constituency, okay? So if I am to invite my supporters to march with them through Kampala, you will all close. A mere 28,000, okay? That's why I have to be regretted. Political behavior that is not regretted will border on irresponsibility, will border on anarchy. So really, fortunately, he is in court.
But the regulation should not be selective.
What do you mean selective? Which other politician is on the streets disorganizing trade order? President Museveni does not even hold rallies in town. If he wants, he goes to Korolo. NRM functions with biggest numbers have gone to Nambole, far away from the city. So really, let's not zero the entire political environment on an individual. Not at all. The individual has a right to aspire to lead. But you must not live in betrayal, in denial. I won. I didn't win. Ugandans know whom they voted for. We know who won where. Okay? The political geography of Uganda is known.
So what will happen when he finally gets on the street or gets back home, and yet he seemed to have this kind of magnet.
But
people,
Patrick,
rally around him.
But Patrick, why are you interested in discussing an issue that is in court?
No, I'm saying that's not a court issue.
Yes.
But I'm saying at the end of the day,
yes,
he's going to be out. He's going to go to Kasangati or wherever it is.
It's up to him to manage his supporters responsibly. If you incite them and say, go and do this, who does not have supporters? Everybody has supporters. I have told you. So should every politician who has supporters order them? Should President Museveni also order his supporters, 5 million plus of them, to come and counterbalance his supporters? I mean, let's look at this responsibly. That's why there is a state to regulate using the instruments of the law. That's why there is a police empowered by Article, I think, 212 or 202, 212, to prevent crime.
So you have proven that
Every
time these political opposition leaders come to town, they actually call the people to follow them?
Whatever the case, we went through an election, okay? Every candidate went wherever he wanted to go. Besia was everywhere in Uganda, in Kamwenge, in my village in Ibigud, he was there. Nobody stopped him. When he saw on the eve of voting, the man came to convene Erware at the other road, where the very busy Nasa road, simply because he wanted that show to boost his chances and confrontation with the police. Museveni didn't go there, President Museveni did not go there. So, as the clergy get concerned, we respect them, they must send a message that every politician should do so, should act and behave responsibly. Otherwise, Uganda, we shall be doing whatever we are doing at the disadvantage of the general public. Yes.
So you come to speak as an information minister during this time. There are things we have seen, for example, in the last couple of days. We had an opportunity, the Israeli Prime Minister visited here, but before that, we had the South Korean leader here. And then
all of that is that, confidence.
Yeah, but then,
yes.
Honorable Frank,
yes,
when they are here and they go maybe to Nairobi, in Nairobi they are meeting business executives, they are signing deals. In Kampala, there's no dividend that you see. When they go to Kigali, you see maybe tourism is getting. When they go to Ethiopia, like Netanyahu was in Ethiopia, he's addressing parliament, he's signing deals. Now, Kenya Islands will soon be flying direct into Tel Aviv. Kenyan students are going to be studying in Israel. And Kenyan businessmen are getting what? When Netanyahu, when he begins from here, we act just more like the regional security guards.
Well. You are right to pose the questions you pose. Mm. We've been signing deals and trade deals. President Uhuru was here, we signed deals, and his own country was up in arms against him. It really depends on what you package. Prime Minister Netanyahu came here for a specific commemoration, okay? That was bigger than an ink on paper for a deal. The fact that airbase was declared as a tourism destination was good enough. It is not anywhere elsewhere. That's why the president was saying, we are turning a sad story into a moment of bonding. So it depends what's your priority of the day. Now, tourism has no borders. It's elastic.
But doesn't it concern you, Honorable Frank, that when we have these leaders from bigger economies, when they come here, we actually maybe in the inconvenience a little and there's nothing much. When they go in the region, mostly Nairobi and Ethiopia, real business work happens
what
there.
What do you mean? When you have bilateral engagements, okay? These bilateral engagements are for trade. Now, and sometimes there's no need to sign a trade deal when there is already an existing pact. You need to check what is existing between us and Israel. You need to check what is existing between us and Korea. We are already having a lot of collaboration between us and Korea. Actually, Korea, you saw signing between the ministers of energy. Before Korea, there was Turkey. Yes, you need to put the facts
now,
right.
In this term,
yes,
the president has said that Uganda is more of a supermarket. I just want to know, you as now who speaks for government, how that is going to change when we have nothing really we are producing that is substantial?
It is going to change when you audit our priorities. Okay? The priorities we are investing in, you are hearing the president supporting innovations. 170 billion shillings Ugandan taxpayers' money put aside to support innovations, agro, chemical, bio, and ICT innovations, okay, to export. When you see these leaders coming here much more frequent, we are opening our borders, we are raising our flag and voice to ensure that our arrivals and tourist visitors increase. Tourism, some people, it's an invisible export. And it's actually that elastic. Because the resource they come to see, the national parks, as long as you continue to secure your animals and you don't allow poachers to eat them, that's a treasure, that's a heritage that we can live on and on. Because ask a question, why are these leaders flocking in here? That's interesting. Look at the swearing in we had of the president. How many presidents did we have? So you cannot say,
you see,
let me finish this point, Patrick.
The tourism, look, in Mombasa alone,
yeah,
it handles many more passengers, or even five times more than Entebbe. Even Kisumu here could be having more passengers than Entebbe. And the kind of money they have put in the tourism sector to market Kenya, magical Kenya, it's on CNN, it's on BBC, it's everywhere. But how much are we doing to market what we have? We can't live by chance.
Agreed. But we'll move at our pace. We are not Kenya. Kenya also has a big brother above it. That big brother also has another big brother above it. You get the point. Kenya has a history, Uganda has a history, Rwanda has a history. Now the question is...
So it doesn't matter to do aggressive marketing?
No. That's not the point. You are simply saying, why are you not Kenya? We are not Kenya.
No, I'm giving you an example.
Yeah, I agreed with you, but...
Which has worked.
Kenya is not the yardstick. There are criticisms, people who critique Kenya. You get the point. There are those who say they are not doing much. So, we benchmark what is good there, as they do to us. We have the Northern Corridor integration. We have very, very many things we are doing in common. That's why we are communicating economically. That's why you have heard of things like one network area. If there are so many different parameters, that integration wouldn't be working. Now, all you are talking about is about how we prioritize spending and what are we able to buy it in each financial year. If you look at the Uganda Tourism Board, that hitherto was really poorly funded, I think its spend on tourism is coming up. More money is being put there. Maybe you will invite here the tourism chief of that board to come and tell how far they are moving. But also, part of this aggressive communication, we want to leave tourism aside. If we brand our narrative about our country, if you heard the speech I was telling them, yes, altercations between politicians internally can be there. But if we all unite as Ugandans to brand our country and resist narratives that brand Uganda wrongly.
So for the people who are going to tell the Ugandan story abroad, have you equipped them? Are they going to speak the kind of language in the same narrative? Are they career diplomats our embassies abroad?
Whether career or not, you actually need more of communicators. You need more of commercial attaches to articulate the progress of Uganda. It is the most stable country. Kampala has been voted so many times as the best destination, beating so many cities. These are rankings from reputable firms. Just somebody needs to tell that story. We have the best climate, okay? We have the best, I don't want to talk somebody. I had a colleague minister from the region. I don't want to mention his or her name. The other day at the airbase, who said, Uganda is actually good. You have not so mountainous, you have lowlands. This is the story of our heritage we need to tell. And it will be told by government, it will be told by politicians, it will be told by everybody. Take an example, a quick one. When you see Honorable Cecilia Ogwar, renowned UPC and now FDC stalwart, anti-government, but leading the campaign to sell the candidature of His Her Excellency Vice President Kazibwe, a known movement supporter, a former vice president. Now that tells you that a culture of being pro-Uganda across political colors is emerging.
Ugandans have loved their country long before. And they still love their country. They get together. You wait when the Comoros is coming here and we're going to play at Namboli.
Now,
you see everybody
thank
there.
Thank you. And that's
Ugandans
the message.
Ugandans love their country. They don't need anybody to tell them. They
need to be told, of course, and enabled. That's why the president is telling them that we're investing money in electricity. We're investing money in roads. Okay.
And in fact, when they fight against you or when they criticize against you, against the government, it's not that they hate you. It's because they love their country more.
Agreed. And that's why we are there to listen. Okay. Criticizing government is different from being anti-Uganda. You get the point. You will criticize the government to put things right. But when you cross the borders, speak for Uganda. And that's, if we agree on that, inshallah, they say. So, what is government doing? Look at our priorities. The president is saying, I will build more roads. I will pay $2-3 billion to fix the railway, to cheapen, to ease the cost of doing business, enable more exports going out, to make sure that our balance of trade is not tilted, having more imports, balance of payments, having more imports than exports.
Yeah, but you see, Honorable Frank, the NRM government and the president, are, in most cases, when they are so good on paper, they are so good on policy, I mean, the proposals they put forward are okay, but the how part of it and the doing part of it, they have failed miserably.
Not at all. Look at the progress. Look at the progress.
So the president has talked about value addition for as long as I can remember.
But look at
where is the value addition?
Go out and see. We are processing coffee. We are packing milk. This never used to be there. We are packing fish. Find out around the Nakawa area how many fish factories are there. Not enough, not adequate, but we are there. We've put money in the budget to support innovations. Today, I was calling upon innovators.
Are these Ugandan businesses owned by Ugandans, most of them?
It doesn't matter. If you're Ugandan, you're Ugandan. So if we are saying we support Kira vehicle, we support Kayora, we support packaging of banana and juice, we support ICT, young people with innovative apps to fix issues. This is for Uganda. It's not for any other person. You get the point. So let's appreciate the journey we have moved. Let's, first of all, appreciate our capacity. Whatever you do, you must do it within your capacity. That's what I was trying to say. We can't be X. We can benchmark what X is doing, but we can't exactly be X. We have our highs, which may be lows of the X, but we also have what we cannot.
But Honorable Frank, you know for sure that in the NRM government, you have always had the strategies. You have already had the policies that are good. You mean well.
Yes.
But then when it comes to implement,
good
that
policies,
becomes a problem.
Good policies, Patrick, stimulate growth, while bad ones stifle development. I don't entirely agree with you. There could be weaknesses that require pulling up a pair of socks in one area or another. If those strategies you talk about are not implemented, then you would not be seeing this growth we are registering. You wouldn't be seeing roads penetrating every district of Uganda. You wouldn't be seeing electricity moving deep down. You wouldn't be seeing the construction industry booming. That tells you people are making profits. Yes, there could be hurting businesses that are aiding because of other challenges. But if the manufacturing sector was not performing, you wouldn't be seeing growth. You wouldn't be seeing electricity being demanded to an extent of government investing trillions of shillings in constructing power dams. If there was no demand for electricity, we wouldn't be bothering ourselves to construct those dams. The fact that there is demand and met tells you that the manufacturing sector is thriving.
We're going to take a break. When we come back, Honorable Frank, I'll be opening the lines that you two at home can call and ask the minister a question you may be having. We'll be right back. Welcome back. You're watching On The Spot. My name is Patrick Kamara. My guest tonight is Honorable Frank Tumwebaze, the Minister of Information and ICT. And talking ICT, there are quite many Ugandans now who have come up with so many innovations, and sometimes they need a little bit of push, you know, a shot in the arm so that they can move, and then ultimately the whole country can benefit. So what do you have for them?
I declared the great news today, and I hope they take it serious. First of all, the president has been talking supporting scientists, and he moved
innovators.
He moved the fund from $5 billion initially, which they gave people of the banana project, to 10, It's now 170 billion. So there was a misunderstanding whether this fund also covers ICT. Now, the other day in our inaugural cabinet, I was able to have that clarified and integrated. ICT innovations have also been mainstreamed. Now, the challenge we have in the sector, which today at the dialogue I put out clearly, because not everything can be an innovation. There will be a superior one, there will be an inferior one with minimal impact. We need, as a sector now, the Ministry of ICT, our agencies, as well as academia, because academia, it's where knowledge is born.
There have always been annual, ICT
award.
Communication innovations,
yes,
which are done by the UCC. And
yes,
when you go there,
yes,
you really see Ugandans have so many amazing, amazing applications,
yes,
that are using.
Uh-huh.
That if you can support them, then we could be the next.
So
you know,
the support is there. All we need is a committee of experts from the academia, from those experts themselves, to be able to tell whether Tumwebaze's innovation is more superior than Kamara's innovation and therefore merits support before Kamara's. It is going to improve.
And whether it is original,
yes,
original and novel.
This we are just going to roll it. Just give me 2 or 3 weeks. We are identifying a committee of eminent people who know the knowledge, who would be like our panel judges, who receive these innovations. And they would be looking at them, they would be interviewing people. At whatever stage the innovation is, it could be incubation, it could be past incubation, it could be patent protection. So, because I am told that some of our young people who have innovated things like me to you, I am not sure, but I need to follow
the sharing
up.
Of areas.
Yes, that was an innovation of our young people. So you ask yourself whether that innovation was rightly paid for, whether this person's intellectual property right was protected, which I guess not. So this fund is there, and I'm really happy about it, to be pioneering the sector with it.
Well, you have been around for about 30 years as NRM, and so I'm sure some of those watching will be wondering, or maybe they have a question in their mind. Is there going to be a time around this time when you start talking about succession? But before you get into that, I'm being told there are some callers online and probably they want to add on the issue of innovation. So let me pick the very first call online. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Good evening, sir. What's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Stephen.
Stephen.
Yes.
Where are you calling from, Stephen?
I'm calling from Zana.
Okay.
Yes. Thank you for the program. I want to say good evening to you, gentlemen.
Good evening, Stephen.
Yes. I want to make one comment.
Mm-hmm.
Frank, I've been following Frank, on several spectrums, and I find his explanations very, very intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
However, I want to tell him that down on the ground, we don't see this reflected.
Okay.
Yes, and that is quite disturbing because, you see, the people who sit at the top of these institutions seem to have the intelligence to handle these institutions. However, the people who come down here to implement have a very, very big problem.
That he,
so
what you're saying is that Frank, when he speaks, maybe he makes sense, but he seems to be making sense only to himself and other people are not picking the sense?
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. All right. Let me pick other callers online. That was Stephen in Zana.
Yes, Patrick.
Hello. How are you, sir?
Yes. Good evening.
Good evening. What's your name and where are you calling from?
I'm Kato Kawesa. I'm calling from Boise.
Cool. Kato Kawesa.
Yes, Katoka Waisa, I'm calling from Boise.
From Boise, on air, sir.
Yeah, I want to first thank Honorable Minister for the what he has told the Ugandans, but my question is about social media.
Mm-hmm.
I want to ask Mr. Tumwebaze, and even to request him to stop that 10 days of whenever they want to stop Ugandans see what is going on, mainly to see what is going on, our opposition leaders to follow up, they switch off social networks. I request Mr. Tumwebaze, you were new in this ministry, so you have to stop that kind of tendency.
Okay, thank you very much. And thank you. And you have an ally here.
He's seriously warning me.
Sometimes, they, you know, and Ugandans sometimes are passing on the innovation to each other, and you disrupt that innovation, those innovations, for reasons that are known only to yourselves. Let me pick two more calls. Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Yes, good evening, sir.
Good evening, how are you, Mr. Patrick?
Good evening. What's your name and where are you calling from?
I'm called Lukundo Paul.
Yes.
I'm calling from Lubowa.
From Lubowa, you're on air, sir.
Yes, I want to thank Colonel Tumwebaze for the good ideas he's bringing in the ICT sector.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe in him because, you see, the government has been lacking a person to communicate. And that's why the opposition has been all over the media, refuting the government. But since we have got a communicator, I think Honorable Frank Tumwebaze will do a very recommendable job in that sector. Thank you so much.
Lukundo Paul, thank you for your call. Let me take the last. Hello. Hello. I'm going to drop that and pick another. Hello. Hello. I have a call online. Hello. Hello.
Yes, hello, Mr. Patrick.
Good evening, sir. What's your name and where are you calling from?
Okay. Look.
I'm sorry? No, you are listening to yourselves. Please, if you want to talk, you turn down the volume of your TV set. Then it will not send an echo to you and to us. Well, we shall have a good engagement. But if the volume is up, we can't talk. Let me take the very last. Hello. Hello? Well, you have also turned up the volume. All right. Well, at least let's pick those three, but they seem to be...
Okay.
Kudos for you.
Okay.
Very uncommon, though.
Very uncommon to get friendly callers on NTV. Maybe sense is beginning to build.
Not on NTV, on contagious issues.
Yes, yes.
Not on NTV.
First of all, Stephen from Zana. Mm-hmm. Thank you for appreciating my ideas, which you say are brilliant. I'm happy. But you say on the ground, they are not reflected. Now, this comes back to the statement I told you, why we are communicating. Now, sometimes things can be done. Sometimes things can be there. But unless you are told where they are, how to access them, you will not know that they are there. If somebody has not told you that the government, for example, has set up a tourism institute in Kasese called Katwe. Okay? It's a government institute. He will not know it. A student in a neighboring secondary school, after senior six, may not know that I can apply to be admitted there. Just like I aspire to be to Nakawa College of Commerce or Kabale, the traditional ones. So maybe, Stephen, first of all, don't get biased. Whether you support the government or not, look out for the support. Like I have told you, there is money for innovation fund. Bring up your innovation. Let's assess it. You will get supported. It doesn't matter whether you even vote for President Museveni or you don't. So the point I conclude with on Stephen is that information is enabler number one to a citizen. Unless they know what the government is doing, their demand will not be stimulated because they will not know where to demand it from. If you don't tell my father in Kamwenge, who has looked after his cows for the last 70 years, with no or minimal government support, he pays for his Akara side, he pays for his vaccines, okay? But sometimes, there are free vaccines at the district. Now, unless you tell him the procedure of how to get the vaccines, he will never know about it. So the power of information, the power of accountability, I think will make people like Stephen to see what is on the ground. And it will also fight corruption. Because if you don't know that there is a service at the sub-county, somebody else can take advantage. Kato, Kawesa, social media shut down. Well, I have been making assurances to some people. The incidences we have had of interfering temporarily, though, with social media, it's been mainly due to cyber threats detected by intelligence. But our engagement now with the security agencies would be to invest much more money in handling cyber security. Because cyber security is for your security. If somebody has capacity to hack into your email, Kamara, okay, as well as my email, that person has capacity to hack into the financial system of a country, okay, since they know it's Oracle, and wipe away all the funds. It has happened in you have heard about high sophisticated fraud. So one of the reasons that has been forcing the intelligence to interfere temporarily with social media is trying to track down those cyber threats.
Those threats are coming during election? They are coming during
Of course, yes. That's when, I mean, you should know for obvious reasons. People do all sorts of things. But what we are going to do now, because all of even government, social media today told people that the internet is no longer a privilege or an option of a few elite. It's a basic right or a necessity, just like electricity or this water is. So we shall safeguard the rights of communicators. We shall also protect you from cyber crime perpetrators. How we shall do it, the security agencies, with the support of the ICT infrastructure, they will know how to do it, they will benchmark, and they will build capacity. But when it happens, just to know, it's not an intention for anything. After all, people normally tell you that if you close social media, we shall invoke a VPN. So that tells
which
you.
Which they always do.
Which they always do. So sometimes shutting down social media may not be really necessary. And sometimes it's not about general shutdown. You find they are targeting a certain server from a certain point, trying to track down some threat of a criminal, and it ends up interfering with the entire network. People sometimes don't understand the dynamics. Because if you're able to get that VPN, if it was an intention of government to curtail everything, you will not even succeed. There are countries that are known really for cutting, for censoring everything, for doing it at as and when they want. But the fact that you can even be able to get that VPN, it tells you government has not really invoked all the capacities. But it's not our intention. How can I shut down social media when I want to communicate every day myself? When I want people to know the amount of money, of prices for food, which they get on their social media pages, on WhatsApp in the villages.
Okay. You seem, Paul, I think, was just...
Paul is
happy with you.
With the communication. So, and I am grateful for him. Thank you.
And in conclusion, there appears to be a conspiracy of silence when it comes to the question of succession. After 30 years, President Museveni in power, I will like to see in the next, these 4 or 5 years, to talk succession debate.
We have just started our term.
Yeah, but
Patrick.
Yes.
We have just started our term.
But you have started a term when the president's term of, constitutionally, he cannot stand again. So
why are you worried about that? The constitution will command us on what to do. First of all, get assured that nothing
is your chairman standing in 2021.
First, wait a minute. Nothing unconstitutional will be done. Whatever will be done in 2021.
Will the constitution be changed?
I don't know what Ugandans think. The constitution is people who own it are Ugandans.
Would you support the amendment?
To do what?
To remove the age limit.
It is not there. How can I support what is not there, Patrick? How can I? Don't make me speculate. I am a minister of information, so I inform you on what I'm certain.
What is going to be your parting shot tonight on the show?
Thank you so much. And once again, today, the dialogue made my day. I just want to thank the media players, the telecom players, the internet, the bloggers who really turned up on short notice, who really showed respect and seriousness to the views we are putting across. And I want to assure you that I too took seriously your concerns. Our secretariat team, our rapporteuring team, noted all your issues. Those who sent them in online, they were recorded. That dialogue will continue. The conversation is unstoppable.
Thank you very much. Honorable Frank Tumwebaze, thank you very much for you at home and all of you who have been a part of this. And this brings us to the end of tonight's edition of the On the Sports Show. Join us again next week when we bring you another edition and we take it a notch higher. Good night and God bless Uganda.